Hey guys, welcome to the Stormkeep. My name is Mrigank, and I'm joined today by.
Hey, it's Paul here, and we're going to be talking about Annihilators.
Hell yeah. Annihilators are probably my favorite archetype in Stormcast Eternals, and we figured it's high time we made a video on how to play these bad boys.
We're only like 2 years late on this, right?
Well, let's just say, well, for the first year, we thought it would kind of be obvious. But these lists, as we have found out, require just a lot of fine-tuning of play, and they're very prone to failure. And so it plus the roll of the dice gods is always something that punishes Annihilator lists more so than others. So we figured we'd make a guide to best to help you best figure your chances out with this list and whether it's something you would like to try out.
Yeah, we had a bit of a journey with this one. When the battle tome first came out, we were incredibly hot on Annihilators. We're like, this is amazing. They're so easy to use. They do so much damage. They do charge mortal wounds and they obliterate stuff. We thought it's going to be obvious how strong these guys are. But then we played it and we were like, oh, this is actually really hard to play. And as you kind of figure out the nuances of how these units work, what they're good at, what they're not good at in particular, you start thinking about how that translates into list construction. And it's actually really hard to put the pieces together for an Annihilator list. So for a little while, we got, I guess, demoralized on Annihilators. We're like, ah, there's just other easier options, things that don't rely on rolling 7-inch charges. But lately, new life has been breathed into this archetype, partly because of all the point changes that happened over the summer. Partly because of the rule changes that happened in the season, but also I think in part because we got new units that really fit into this style, like the Questor Soulsworn really works well in this style of list. All right, before we jump into the video, let's talk about our sponsor for the Stormkeep podcast, Kaiju Gaming Lounge. Located in Orlando, Florida, Kaiju Gaming Lounge is the official sponsor. They supply all the prizes for our painting contest. They also sell our merch. We have these fancy 9-inch, 7-inch range markers with our logo on there. Those are great for playing Annihilators in particular. So if you want to measure 9 inches or 7 inches off the table, you can do so with these handsome-looking colored range finders, or go for the clear option, which is also a good one. We also have dice coming back into stock. So if you're interested in picking up a set of Stormkeep dice, they should be available now. You can use Stormkeep to get 15% off all Warhammer at kaijugaminglounge.com. Okay, Mergonk, run us through what are Annihilator lists exactly. How many Annihilators do you put in an Annihilator list? How do you form them? How do they play? Let's just dive into it.
All right, cool. So Annihilator lists in general are a Stormcast Eternals list archetype based on primarily using Signs of the Storm to deploy units in reserve and then drop them 7 inches away using the Lord Imperatin's Guided by Lightning ability. As you can probably suggest, the Lord Imperatin is a must-take in this list. We do not recommend creating lists that have to rely on 9-inch charges.
Right, and also make sure you're playing Signs of the Storm. This is not, despite being the namesake, we don't recommend playing Stormkeep with this list in
Nope.
particular.
Yeah, so the list, what it really wants to do, what its primary game plan is to focus on precision strikes and have essentially table-wide threat ranges so your opponent doesn't really have a lot of places to hide. And they have to deploy very carefully against this type of lists. As the name would suggest, Annihilators are the primary hammer unit in these lists. And so your typical combination of lists will include a Lord Imperatant and up to 2 units of Annihilators. There was a time I think we used to do three, and I think three is still playable in some ways, but as you mo test with this list further, you might realize you only need two. And these can be a combination of Annihilators with shields, Annihilators with meteoric grand hammers, although we do find ourselves using the latter more as they are simply more efficient. Now, this doesn't mean that only uses Annihilators. Luckily, the Lord Imperatin's Guided by Lightning ability also applies to all Stormcast infantry units that are in Thunderstrike armor configuration. So that would mean Vanquishers, Vindictors, Questor Soulsworn, even Vigilords, if you're the person who's, one of the five people who's playing Vigilords right now.
I don't see a scenario where you'd ever want to drop Vigilor 7 inches away. That doesn't seem like a good use of that ability to me.
Yeah, but if you have them, sure, why not? So yeah, all of these can use Guided by Lightning, so dropping them 7 inches away and having a sort of 82% chances of a charge after a reroll, it's pretty good. So it's a good ability. So how do we use this? Well, first thing to remember is Annihilators, although they're very powerful units, they do a lot of mortal wounds, they do a lot of damage, they are extremely slow and they are few in number. They don't have a lot of wounds going on. So in terms of sustainability on the field, they will probably die to any amount of like casual focus that's directed towards them. And because of their 4-inch movement, once they drop and charge, that is the rough area where they will be fighting. They're very good at it, but remember that that's the area they'll be concentrated on. So it's only one turn, one unit a turn can use the Guided by Lightning ability. It means that if you were planning to use it, if you're planning to use a number of units to drop 7 inches away, the maximum units you can do is 3. So build your lists according to that. Don't put 4 Annihilators in your list because you'll be dropping one of them 9 inches away and then trying to do 9-inch rollable charges, which, again, we don't recommend.
Yeah, it also puts too many units in reserve, and then you won't have enough stuff on the table for those first 3 rounds, and you could just have units on the table instead, right? So even though they are called Annihilator lists, like if you over-index on Annihilators, they're just not good at all.
Mm-hmm. It's strange because they are sort of the they are what the list is named after, but the list consists of majority of other units designed to support what Annihilators are trying to do.
Yeah.
Because of how, like, sort of these explosive, tiny packages of efficiency that they are.
I've made Annihilator lists that have only one unit of Annihilators. Like, they're so central to the playstyle that the whole thing is named after them. And they're kind of like a psychological warfare element, too, right? Like, when your opponent sees, oh, I'm playing against Grandhammers, they have to completely change their game plan, especially because almost nobody does this style. So you're going to find enemies make mistakes all the time against this. So that will help offset the inherent randomness of failing a 7-inch charge. Or so I hear that can happen. I don't know about you, Mrigank. Have you ever failed a 7-inch charge?
I have failed them. Contrary to what people believe, I don't hold a monopoly on that cosmic entity that determines 7-inch charge rolls. But I have made a fair few of them. I think the most I've ever missed in a, let's say, 15 charges, maybe is like 1 or 2. And yeah, it sucks when you miss. Unfortunately, that's a risk you're just going to have to take. The good news is, you know, it's not like your charges are always going to be 7. It's not like you're going to, you know, move 3 inches up to the enemy and then they use a redeploy and then they redeploy 6 inches away. That just feels bad when you fail that charge, or like they just roll a lucky redeploy. It's always going to be 7, so there's some kind of like consistency there. But anyways, because of, you know, Annihilators do have that limitation of being slow, being few in number, of having that failure point, we use other units to sort of shore up those lists. And this could be fast units like Dracolines, Chariots, Stormdrake Guard, Aether Wings. This could be shooting units like Long Strikes, Tempestors, and Judicators. We almost always typically, like, you don't have to, but it helps you out if you have a priest for translocation, and we'll discuss why later when we discuss how this kind of list likes to play. And recently, Vanguard Hunters and Knights Zephyros are like quite a popular choice for battle tactics. You will require a minimum, some kind of screening units, particularly because while this list sort of has unlimited sort of table threat range and can hit the opponent from, you know, way across the map, unfortunately, when it's their turn, they're going to go screaming for your head. And because this list is extremely light on bodies, usually there's not much in the way to stop them. So you will need some screening units to protect like a key hero, like your priest that translocates, or like your Vanguard Raptors or something. All right. So how do Annihilator lists play? The playstyle is effectively extremely defensive. You want to think of it as like almost like a castle that you have, but not in the traditional way you would think of castles, like a Lumineth or like a Slaanesh castle. The idea is you keep your opponent out of your opponent's threat range, so there's no way they can possibly get to you turn one. Because Annihilators can essentially deep strike from reserve anywhere on the field 7 inches away, the rest of the army doesn't need to be nearby. The Lord Imperatin does not need to be nearby to employ the 7-inch signs of the storm drop. Long range damage like long strikes, Aerablaze Comet, Lightning Blast are pretty good because they help get rid of your opponent's screens from from vast distances, and there's very little ways for your opponents to get to them also. Annihilators are always deployed in reserves. Please do not deploy Annihilators on the ground thinking, oh, you know, I might need something if my opponent gets close to me. If they get close to you, you should have some secondary threats like chariots and maybe some shooting to help deal with anything that can threaten you with speed.
Yeah, if you're not putting Annihilators in reserve, you shouldn't use them. Straight up, they should not be in your list. You should bring a unit like Retributors or Protectors or even Questers instead.
Mm-hmm. The Lord Imperator can be deployed in reserve or on the table. This really just comes down to what kind of list you are fighting. Oftentimes when I find myself fighting, like, say, a Luminate list, or when I used to fight a Luminate list back when they were popular, they typically have a teleport in their pocket also. Since the Lord Imperator is effectively the engine for the Annihilators and the other Thunderstrike infantry units, you do not want him sniped out. So you definitely want to deploy them in reserves if your opponent has extremely long-range shooting or some sort of magic damage themselves, and you can't deal with all of it. If you have a key unbind that could take care of something like an Umbral Spell Portal, and you know your Lord Imperator is not going to die in a turn, sure, you can leave him on the table and deploy a key unit in reserve to protect that unit instead. And when you're fighting something like a pure melee list, the Lord Imperator can be on the ground. There's, like, really no reason. They're not really under any threat if you deploy them far enough back. Typically, he would also be the recipient of the Arcane Tome, and so you might miss out on a spell or an Antorian Acolyte's 3+ Primal Dice bonus if they are in reserve. So keep that in mind when you decide to deploy. After that, you just deploy one unit of Annihilators, or really any Thunderstrike unit based on whatever threat you're trying to deal with. 7 inches away. If it's an Annihilator, you'll deal some mortals to all enemy units within 10. And then you charge and you deal mortals based on what your charge roll is on dice rolls of 4+, based on your unmodified charge roll. Shooting and cavalry support Annihilators or play objectives while they're distracted. And what this means is Annihilators sometimes aren't enough to take care of stuff. So you will need a combination of either other melee units, depending on what your distances are, or shooting to sort of 1-2 punch, destroy key enemy units. And you'll need things to contest circles, because Annihilators are only 3 models, and like it is unlikely that they will be able to contest anything if, like, 2 units are contesting it and they can only kill one. Given this list's low wound count, you will often feel like you are sort of neck and neck for the first 2 rounds or 3 until you kill enough things to where you start pulling ahead. But even then, as you win, you will realize you have won sort of, like, Pyrrhic victories. It's almost very thematic, like, given the Stormcast lore, where, you know, most models are dead, you're yourself down to maybe, like, 8 or 9 models, but you will win on victory points, and there's not much your opponent can do about it. So yeah, it's a very rewarding playstyle, if a very careful and sort of calculated playstyle.
Yeah, try to picture, like, a typical old-school army that would have, like, artillery in the back, firing away as the enemy moves up into the midfield, but as you're doing that, you're dropping these, like, Annihilator bombs that are coming crashing in and distracting them. You have some cavalry on the flanks that are holding objectives, taking out other cavalry from your opponent that's trying to get around the sides. You've got magical spells going off. You've got strong defensive bonuses from things like the Knight and Cantor canceling spells, or just tons of screens like Aether Wings and Redeemers holding the line, just giving you more time for your long strikes to keep shooting, your Annihilators to keep dropping in. Like, all you're trying to do is buy time until that, like, round 3 where you turn the corner and turn it into a victory. And when it all works, it's super fun. Like, it's really, really fun to play this. It's exhausting, though. That's another thing we didn't really mention here in the slides, is, like, you get tired after, like, a game or two of this, right? Like, by the time you get to round 3 in a day, you're pretty exhausted.
Yeah, and also, yeah, it can be very exhausting trying to figure out, because a lot of the thinking in this list, and we'll get to this later when we discuss how to play, is about target priority. And about how to sort of use the turn order advantage to your favor,
mm-hmm.
in certain situations.
And threat ranges. Oh, you have to know everything your opponent can do. It's a tremendous amount of knowledge.
Yep, you have to know if they can run and charge. You have to know if they can teleport. You have to know if they shoot. How far do they move in addition? You have to know how far their spells can go. You have to know if something has wards, if something can fight first. You know, all these little things.
Yeah, you have to know if they have combinations of these things. Like, if this hero teleports in range of this unit, then this unit can do a thing. And you have to kind of try to predict all of this. And if you ever get caught out and just mess up one of these things, like, you start losing units. And you can't really lose units early with this list, because...
You can't afford to lose units in this army that don't produce value.
Right. Like, you've got units...
A unit that hasn't achieved anything is a death sentence for
right.
this list.
If you lose your long strikes top of round one, that's really bad. Whereas if you lose five vanquishers and then you recycle them with call for aid, well, that's great. That's exactly what they're supposed to do, is they're supposed to die so that other things don't. So every unit in this list has a purpose. You need to know what that purpose is. You need to know what your opponent can do, how they do it, how they're going to try to do it, how what you can do about it. It's a lot of thinking, but it is a lot of fun. So let's talk strengths and weaknesses. They are fun, like I said. There's a ton of different Stormcast lists you could play. So why would you consider playing Annihilators instead of something like, you know, Dragon Spam or just six Tempesters or big dragons? Like, there's so many different styles you can play with Stormcast, so why pick Annihilators? Well, one of the big reasons, I think, is you have table-wide threat ranges. And if you thought, you know, deep strike shooting was fun, like if you tried that with Stormcast and you found, oh, this is pretty cool. Well, what about reliable deep strike charging? That's not really anything you can find anywhere else in this army. Annihilators are the unit that hits where you want them to, when you want them to. Assuming you roll a 7+, but let's assume we are, right? between the precision damage that Grand Hammers do and any amount of long-range shooting, like if you have long strikes or the Everblaze Comet to deal more mortal wounds, you can really just tear down anything across the table whilst keeping the rest of your army in your deployment and, like, losing nothing in exchange. You're just trading up constantly until your opponent can get to you, and you're going to make it very, very expensive for them to get to you. Grand Hammers themselves are super high-impact units. Everybody is terrified of what Grand Hammers can do between the impact mortal wounds when they land on the table, the charge mortal wounds, and then, you know, 30 max damage, which will usually be on 2s, 2s, rend 2. They are just a tremendous amount of damage output for only 220 points. And you can pump them up even further if you use the Wizard Finder Battalion to give them a significant damage boost against things like... Oh, anybody with an Arcane Tome. So if you're fighting like Ogres, they'll usually have an Arcane Tome on a Stonehorn, or Sons of Bahamut with an Arcane Tome, Vampire Lord on Zombie Dragon, every Flesh Eater Court hero, I believe, is a wizard, Lord Croak, any support hero. Like, Wizard Finders is really good for pumping their damage up even further. And there's actually not a lot of armies that can take advantage of Wizard Finders right now, so that's a pretty cool thing in their favor. Annihilators have a very small footprint, and what we mean by that is just the physical amount of space taken up on the table. To make it very obvious what this means is, compare the space taken up by something like 20 zombies, compare that to 3 Annihilators. Like, the Annihilator bases are much smaller, and when you combine that with a 7-inch deployment, like more than 7 inches from enemies, it's really, really hard for your opponent to stop you from deploying somewhere. They have to play very cagey, very tightly condensed, and that really just allows your shooting to just go to town on them. If you have any AoE damage, like if you have Knight Vexillors, or if you have the Everblaze Comet, anything that does damage to every unit in an area, well, they're going to be punished severely for grouping up. And then as soon as they spread out, the Annihilators can start raining down and picking off key units one at a time. The MSU style, or the multiple small unit style, this means you don't really reinforce units. You just have lots and lots and lots of small sized units, which is a weird thing with Stormcast because you don't have that many units. But as opposed to, say, bringing a unit of reinforced Evocators and, you know, double reinforced Tempesters, MSU would be just 3 Grand Hammers here, 3 Grand Hammers there, 5 Liberators, like this lower unit count, basically, or lower unit size. And when you use this kind of style, people are bringing, like, you know, 6 Varangard. 6 Varangard are pretty much going to obliterate most things that they hit. There's not a lot of units that can stall them for more than a turn. So the difference between hitting, you know, 3 Annihilators or hitting another unit of 6 Varangard, it's a pretty big difference, right? Whereas the difference between hitting 3 Annihilators or hitting 6 Annihilators, well, you're going to kill them all the same, right? There's functionally, defensively, no difference between these two units, at least not one that's significant enough. However, you still have to dedicate the resources to do it, right? So that usually requires overextending, because if you take out smaller units throughout the game, like, let's say this hypothetical six Vanguard list that I'm talking about, if you take out the unit of Chaos Knights that's with them or the Splintered Fang, well, then if they want to deal with the Grand Hammers, they have to send the Vanguard into the Grand Hammers. And then you're trading, how many points are Vanguard right now? Like almost 300? So let's say like 600 points of Vanguard have spent a turn killing 200 points of Grand Hammers. And that's just a fantastic trade for you. And that's after your Grand Hammers have charged and killed something, presumably. And all this time, your opponent is clearing out the Annihilators. Well, you have more time to shoot. You have more time to move around the board, contest objectives, snipe out heroes, advance your game plan. So not only are Grand Hammers a tremendous damage unit, they're also a great tactical unit. And the tactical value of them is really understated because it's not obvious. You can't just see that when you look at the War Scroll. The Knight and Cantor is definitely worth mentioning in this style, because when you want to play this very defensive playstyle, the Knight and Cantor covers a lot of bases for you. There's always one spell per game that you just want to, like, without rolling a dice, that's gone. When just the threat of it can force your opponent to not make certain plays. So let's say you're trying to deny a teleport spell and you deploy your Knight and Cantor in range of the wizard that has the teleport spell. Well, it's like, as soon as they cast that, it's gone. And the difference of one, just canceling one turn for that spell, it can swing the game, right? Because that's one turn they're not hitting your long strikes. That's one more turn of long strikes that get to shoot at your opponent. And that can just be game changing. You know, it's all about momentum. Alternatively, the Knight and Cantor can also be used to, you know, defensively keep with the rest of your units. And then as soon as they teleport a wizard forward, and this seems to be a common tactic with Stormcast, obviously, we're teleporting wizards forward to cast. Lumineth and their Lore Seekers, they love to be forward at the start of the game. Lord Croak can be teleported forward. Skaven teleport their heroes forward. As soon as they do that, you've got a Dispel Skull ready to cancel something. And that's a pretty big deal. Even just denying a defensive spell like Mystic Shield, that can be a game changer for Grand Hammers. Because if they can't get Mystic Shield and they can't all out defense, like let's say you find a way to shut that down as well, that run two starts to really, really hurt. Taking units from 3-up save to 5-up is a tremendous reduction in their effective health. And the last big strength, I think, of Annihilators is that their defensive playstyle coupled with their reserve units, like the fact that they rely on reserve units, because you could play a defensive style without reserves, right? Something like a Hallow Strike list, where you have a Gardas castle with lots of screens up front, long strikes, and then like a cavalry hammer to punch enemies as they come into you. That's cool, but you don't have those units in reserve. So if your opponent can get to you, they can start wiping out your hammer units. So this specific style of having units in reserve, playing defensively, and then having a table-wide threat range, that can just nullify an opponent's double turn. You know, so you can be forced to go first, score some easy battle tactics, score some easy victory points with almost nothing spent. Your opponent can't kill any units that are in reserve. So since you're so far away and your opponent can't destroy anything useful, well, they get a turn, doesn't do much, and then they get a proper turn, and they're actually in range to hit things, but a lot of the things they want to hit aren't even on the table yet. So this kind of style in particular plays well into enemy double turns once you really understand the ins and outs of it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, what you'll often find is when we discuss some of the weaknesses of this list and later sort of play subtleties, because your opponents know that you are not on the field most of the time, like most of your threats are in reserve, especially battle round one, there's not much for them to do. So it there's sort of a weird mind game going on where if they make the mistake of taking the first turn and you double them with Annihilators, the game is often over really quickly. Like, if you get two turns back-to-back with Annihilators near, like, their defensive castle position, the game is just over. So they have to sort of make you go first so you can leverage sort of that mind game knowledge against your opponent and play accordingly. But do keep in mind that you do have to constantly account for the fact that you might get doubled. But fortunately, like we mentioned, your threat ranges are so large that oftentimes that won't be an issue for you.
Oh yeah, it's quite easy to stay out of most threat ranges in the game. And then you can spend your first turn trying to just delete the things that have longer threat ranges. So it's just a really satisfying playstyle when you get the hang of it. Let's talk weaknesses. Mrigank, take it away with the weaknesses of Annihilators.
Yeah, well, the first and foremost, I feel like we have to mention, you have to be able to roll sevens. I don't care if you have like a litany of Sigmar that you have to chant, if you kiss your dice before you roll them or you blow on them, but just you know, if you're superstitious and you have any such methods to improve your rolls, you need to try them, because if you can't roll 7-inch charges, Annihilators aren't going to do their job, and oftentimes they're going to fail. Fortunately, you do get a free reroll with them, which is incredibly useful, because it gives you about an 82% chance to make your charge successfully. You will still fail them 1 out of 6 times. It's a lot lower for me. I have no clue why, but that's just how it is. That's all we have to say about that. But as to the weaknesses of the unit itself, Annihilators are an incredibly fragile and a really poor wound count unit. They are extremely efficient at what they do, but my god, they will not survive any sort of like dedicated attention from your opponent. And it's often because your opponent knows how dangerous that they can be, like your opponent will make sure to wipe them when it's their turn. So you can effectively call it a glass cannon unit, although they don't, you know, with how tanky they look and with their 3-up save, it might not seem that way. You can't really stack any bonuses on them, so, you know, no Mystic Shields, nothing like the Lord Castellan Slight or anything like that. So they are basically what it says on the tin, you know, when they come down from the sky. They have virtually no mortal wound defense, and generally we don't recommend playing this with Guardians, because Annihilators will be required to go in extremely awkward positions on the board sometimes, and that's not a position you want to commit a unit like Guardus Steel Soul to.
No, and Guardus's ward is an effective health multiplier of 150%, so you're only adding somewhere between 4 and 5 wounds to that unit on average, and that's just not worth the 160 points on Guardus.
Yeah. Yep. Also, they're extremely vulnerable to reactive damage. This includes abilities like Unleash Hell. This could be something like a Fights First. This could be something like a Stomp. Some monsters have this like a more sort of like upgraded stomp where they do like d3 plus 3 mortal wounds or something like that, and these guys are only 3 wounds, so you know your opponent could lucky and like pop an annihilator with just like a normal stomp, and that's really bad. So in order to sort of mitigate this, we generally either charge in ways where we do not suffer from a monstrous rampage by charging something 3 inches away from that monster, or we play sub factions like Astral Templars, because Annihilators, fortunately, don't have enough of a footprint where you will often be forced to sort of engage monsters if you don't want to. So this can, you know, obviously, if you play Gargants, like, you have no choice. But, you know, we have other tools against Gargants. There's other things we can do. It relies on the Lord Imperitant being alive on the table, at least for the first 2 turns. So make sure your Lord Imperitant is not in a position where if your opponent gets a double turn, he's dead. Because if that happens, you'll be very sad trying to do rollable 9-inch charges with, and you won't get the Guided by Lightning anymore. And in some ways, the Lord Imperitant, other than the 7-inch charge, doesn't feel like they're doing a lot, so it can feel like a tax on this army. We often mentioned in some of our previous videos how a Stormdrake Guard is 340, but if you divide the cost of an Imperitant by 2 Annihilator units, they cost about the same as dragons do. Right now, I think they're about 300 points. If you take 2 units of Annihilators and Imperitant, you're effectively, each Annihilator unit is about 300 points. They're a low volume of attacks, and although they have pretty good precision, because a lot of times you will find them on 2s and 2s with all-out attack or a nice Excelsior buff, rolling 1s on any of those just feels so bad. You lose about 3 damage a pop from every 1 you roll. And low rolls absolutely kill this unit. And you don't even also have to just to watch out for your below average rolls, but you also have to keep in mind your opponent's above average rolls. I have lost many a game where my opponent will spike their saves or spike, you know, some ward saves or something. And cool, it's like this unit did not do what it was supposed to do. I have no tools to mitigate this. So
I can say from personal experience, there's been plenty of times where I'll have a unit after the charge mortal wounds, after everything, you get into combat and you're like, okay, so there's 3 wounds left on this unit. I just need 1 dice to get through the hit wound save, and this unit's dead, right? So you dedicate even 2 models, and you roll a bunch of 1s, and then your opponent makes a bunch of 5-up saves, and you're like, ugh. It just feels awful when the low roll happens.
Yeah, and for me, it's happened where my opponents rolled like 4 6s in a row, and, you know, there's not much you can do. You know, it's a dice game. You just sort of have to accept it and move on. But the thing to learn from this is that while the Annihilators do good damage, they might not be enough damage. Like we mentioned that most hammers in the game are something people tend to reinforce because they sort of want to get past that unpredictability of dice. you can't really, we don't recommend reinforcing Annihilators because you're, like we mentioned, the reliant on 7 and charge rerolls and their fragility as minuses to this unit, or sort of weaknesses of this unit. Reinforcing that weakness doesn't seem like a good point. Their strength is in their MSU playstyle. But unfortunately, it means you will require other damage to support them for them to be able to do their job properly. This could be shooting damage. This could be other melee damage, but you have to help them out. You have to give them a little bit of support.
Yeah. Let's take a moment to talk about what a thrill ride it is to run 6 Grand Hammers or 9 Grand Hammers in a single unit and have them land and finish the charge and actually have a good target to hit. That is a fantastic feeling.
It is. It's just very rare in AOS these days.
Yeah, it's like most of the time, like I could maybe see 6 in a single unit. But like as soon as you fail that 7-inch charge, you've just delivered a quarter of your army or about a fifth of your army to your opponent on the table. And it's a very easy fifth to kill. So that's, you know, 440 points gone and your guided by lightning is used and your whole turn was probably based around them making the charge. Right. So that's just too risky. So we strongly do not recommend using reinforced Grand Hammers.
So, yeah. So, and finally, I would say their decision-making is incredibly complex. We mentioned that this list requires sort of like a high knowledge barrier. You have to know what your opponent is capable of, both in melee and abilities and threat ranges. And so you have to know what they can do and what they are going to do if they get a double. You sort of have to be able to predict that. And that can get in the way of mastering this list. Board positioning is absolutely critical. If you misposition something and they die to like a double turn because you underestimated your opponent's threat ranges, you'll lose the game instantly if your Lorded Periton dies or something. Target priority is crucial. You can't just land Annihilators anywhere and expect them to hit something that isn't worth hitting for them. You have to know what to hit and when to hit it, and you have to know what units to help them out with to be able to for them to do their jobs. This third pointer will require a bit more explanation. You have to know how to effectively create units, meaning, so it's a bit of a continuation of the previous point. Like, you can't just hit, like, a chaff unit with Annihilators because it's not worth it. But we mentioned how a lot of times your opponents will make you go first because of this list, because of this, like, you don't have all your threats on the board, and they want your things to be on the board to be able to kill them. Oftentimes, because of how fragile Annihilators are, you will find that they do their job. They land, they charge, they destroy something. Then your opponent finishes them off. And this means you're effectively trading units. And this can work really well for you if you're fighting a list that is about par as you are in terms of like points to unit efficiency. This can work really badly for you if you're like fighting something that has just tons and tons of, like, you know, chaff and cheap units. So knowing when to land Annihilators and knowing how to play them, or maybe trying for a double turn so you can get more value out of Annihilators, is going to be important when you fight different sorts of lists and armies.
Yeah. Well, let me give you a quick example here to demonstrate what you're talking about. If Grand Hammers deploy and charge and kill a unit of 10 skeletons, you've destroyed 100 points worth of units. And your opponent on your turn or their turn can just revive that unit, right? So you haven't really done much. And then your opponent will have the opportunity to kill your Grand Hammers, who are 220 points. However, if your Grand Hammers land and do a bunch of mortal wounds to a bigger unit, like let's say a Vampire Lord on Zombie Dragon, and then they charge in and kill it, you've now done 480 points worth of damage. I forget exactly how much the Vampire Lord is, but it's over 450. In exchange for 210... or 220 for Grand Hammers. You will probably have to add a bit of shooting into that, so it's not like it's a completely even trade or anything. But then your opponent has to spend resources dealing with that 220-point unit. And those are resources that, without the unit like the Vampire Lord, like, what else in the army can really do that job reliably? They're going to have to over-dedicate resources. They're going to have to put things like a Merciless Blizzard into them, use all their Primal Dice. They're going to have to swamp you with Jedwalker Zombies. They're going to have to, if they have Blood Knights in the list, put those in there, right? So it's like, as soon as you take out key pieces and you make it really awkward for your opponent to come back and kill the Grand Hammers, you're trading up. But if the opposite is true, you're just taking out useless things, you're trading down. And you never want to be trading down with Annihilators.
Yeah. And this, when we don't discuss this further, but because of this sort of trading system with Annihilators, it can sort of be good or not good in the meta, basically, based on like how efficiently the newer battle tomes or the armies are at the time.
Yeah, and how much reactive damage there is. That's a big part of it, right? Like, if there's a lot of monsters, you can get around that by teching into Astral Templars. But let's say there's a lot of things like murder rolls from Khorne or Deadwalker zombies doing mortal wounds when they die. Annihilators don't do very well into that because they trade as you kill them. So it's always pretty much an even trade into units like that.
Mm-hmm.
I think
so if they have just have more stuff than you, you'll often find yourself running out of steam.
Yeah, and I think this is where the last point comes in here, is that all of these weaknesses are just inherent to this unit, and there's nothing you can do about it. Like, you can't bring a different sub-faction, or you can in the case of Stomp, but the rest of your list has to be built to accommodate all of these weaknesses. That way, when you play Annihilators, it's all strengths, right? You're getting the most you can get out of that unit, and then the rest of your army is accounting for everything else. So we'll show you guys a series of lists here that'll demonstrate exactly this concept. So the first one, actually, you can talk about this one, Mrigank. It's the OG Annihilana Grande, the Knights Excelsior version.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so this list has gone through several changes over the past 2 years since the book came out. This is the most recent version that I've landed upon, and although I'm sort of working with the version that we'll see after this, which is a more Astral Templar-based version, this was the original idea. Knights Excelsior unlocks Annihilators as battle line, which makes it incredibly efficient, since you don't have to spend points on taking battle line units. The core of this list is the Lord Imperitant, the Knight Relictor, and the Knight Incantor. The Knight Relictor has High Priest for reliable translocations. The Knight Incantor is Merciless Blizzard because, like we mentioned, most of your hammer units are in reserve, so you're not really buffing anything. Then we have two units of Vanguard Raptors because we like long ranges and we want to be able to take out screens or take out key units and sort of be prepared for a double. And minus two, you know, we got, 12 shots at negative two rend, two damage with mortal wounds on sixes. It's still pretty efficient shooting, given that it's now 230 points. We have a unit of Castigators, and this was more because I had the space for them as in addition to the Aether Wings, because they give us a little bit more of that shooting damage and just like those three extra bodies you might sometime need to take an objective and you don't want to commit like a Vanquisher unit or a Questor Soulsworn unit or a Vanguard Raptor unit or a Hero 2. So having a bit more bodies for tactics and holding objectives is pretty good. And their shooting damage isn't bad for 90 points. It's like a slot in. Aether Wings to support the Raptors, obviously. And then the newest addition is two units of Questor Soulsworn. This used to be two Chariots, but as the meta has sort of gone on, what I've realized is although the Chariots were good anvils at a time when a lot of lists like Iron Jaws are really popular, they didn't really help me take objectives. They would do their damage, and you know it would be enough or not enough depending on whether I supported them with Annihilators or Vanguard Raptors. Questor Soulsworn filled that niche very nicely because they teleport themselves, so I don't have to waste like a High Priest teleport on them. I can use it on something like Vanguard Raptors to reposition them if I have to. They count as 18 on objectives, and this was the major, major problem this list always had, was how do I take objectives if I can't wipe this unit out? So if I fought something like 30 skeletons and I only kill about 20 of them, well, good, you know, 20 skeletons are gone. They're probably not going to kill my Annihilators back, but I'm not taking the objective back from them either. Questor Soulsworn solved that problem very nicely. So that is a very welcome addition to this list.
Hmm. Yeah, so this is pretty much like the core of an Annihilator list. Like, you take all the good stuff, you have a little bit of room left over for things like Aether Wings, Castigators, but this is everything we talked about, right? We want bodies, the Questors come in and fill that role. We want objective count, the Questors do that. We want more teleporting, Questors do that. We want the Long Strike Raptors because we want long-range damage. We want the screens, so we've got Vanquishers, Aether Wings, and in a pinch, the Castigators are screens as well. So this is everything we were talking about. But you can see from this little radar chart that we have on the right side that it's really lacking in a lot of key ways, this season in particular. I think it's worth talking about that in particular. So first off, this is just about the slowest Stormcast list you could ever play. And I don't mean it can't teleport. It's got plenty of mobility, right? It's got two different teleporting Questor units. It's got the Knight Relictor with Translocate. It's got units coming out of reserve. But once those units are on the table, that's it. They're not you know, going to the other side of the table and just running and charging and hitting a unit on an objective and taking it. So this is an incredibly slow, purposeful, methodical play style. So the speed is very, very low. Magic, in terms of an average Stormcast magic list, this is below average, right? You have two wizards, no endless spells. The only spell you've learned here is Merciless Blizzard, so you don't have Celestial Blades to put on the Questor Soulsworn. There's going to be a lot of turns where you're playing this list and you're just casting Mystic Shield and Arcane Bolt, or just not casting a spell at all, right? So it's below average in terms of magic. In terms of magic defense, all it has is two unbinding, third one available with the Knight Relictor, but it's not like particularly good at magic defense either. And melee, it's good. It's got a lot of melee hammers, and melee hammers are really useful for trading up on objectives and taking control of objectives in the same turn, and for counterattacking enemy hammers, right? If somebody charges into a screen, you can have the Questor Soulsworn riposte immediately after they wipe the screen out. So it's got a good melee score. It has an average shooting score. I'd say like two units of long strikes is about the average damage output. Maybe this could be argued to be a four in shooting because you've got the castigators in there as well. But it's about average shooting for Stormcast these days, right? We're bringing more shooting than this usually. In defense, it's like rock bottom as well. It's everything that takes damage will just die as soon as it takes damage. Questers are the most durable thing in this list, but they're still only 18 wounds on a 3-up save. So it's like having two Stormdrakes. So although Questers are great, and we can't stop talking about how great they are, in terms of defense, on their own, they're not particularly strong. Like, yeah, you can Mystic Shield one of them, then translocate them, and then they can all-out defense and then have, you know, a 1+ save. That's great, but it's still only 18 wounds. So if your opponent wants to cut through it with a bunch of heavy focus fire, they can still do it. Model count's quite high here. And I think that's because of the inclusion of the Questers. Before we had this unit available, we'd be bringing things like Chariots, like you mentioned, Mrigank, and that the model count was quite lower in these lists. But in terms of complexity, it's still up there, right? This is as complex as Stormcast lists get. It's really hard to play this. It requires a tremendous amount of knowledge of what you and your opponent can do. And then in battle tactics, this list really struggles. This is going to struggle to do things like intimidate the invaders and surround and destroy, because you don't have units that can continuously teleport, like Vanguard Hunters or Knight Zephyros. The only units that do teleport are the Questers, right? And you don't want them on the flanks. You want them in the middle of the battlefield contributing damage or defense in some way. Overshadow is tough here. Let into the Maelstrom is tough here because you don't want to charge your heroes, and your Annihilators have to survive the combat, which... that's tough because they usually either die or obliterate everything within 3 inches. So, yeah, you're really struggling for battle tactics with this type of list here.
Yes, that is the problem with this list. Previous two seasons or three seasons, whatever, I didn't find myself struggling for battle tactics at all. But this new recent season has really made it harder because it's really emphasized units that have to be on the field to complete that battle tactic. So you can't just like do something out of reserves and complete it. And our faction battle tactics, well, enough said about that. Hopefully we're getting a Battlescroll soon to fix that problem. But that is one of the reasons we sort of moved away from this list and we moved on to a different version of this list that sort of plays this season's battle tactics better. Paul, if you want to move us to that one.
Yeah, let's do it.
Paul, do you want to just talk about this one?
Yeah. Sure, yeah. I made this one for Lords of the Storm, our recent video that came out short time ago, depending on when you watch this video. We called this one Nuclear Launch Detected because it is all about just teleporting units around in unpredictable ways. The typical Grand Hammer package with Questers, double Long Strike Raptors. But what differentiates this one really, I think, is the inclusion of long-range spells. Things like the Everblaze Comet, the Malevolent Maelstrom, that made it feel like you were just, you know, setting up a nuke and launching it. And I'm a big StarCraft fan, so that's where the pun comes from. But you can see what this list trades out is it trades out Battleline Grand Hammers. It fills those slots with Vanguard Hunters, which are really useful for doing battle tactics. Sometimes they're screens, sometimes they're teleporting and stealing objectives. Sometimes they're teleporting to table edges and scoring you surround and destroy. They're a very, very versatile unit for scoring battle tactics. So you get a few more of those and you get the endless spells. And what do you give up? You just give up one unit of Questers to get all that utility. You can see the magic score is quite a lot higher here because the additional endless spells are quite good. They add a lot of magic damage, which is actually really important for this kind of playstyle. Any damage you can do before the movement phase is super important because you drop down in the movement phase, and if you clear out models, that gives you more room to drop down. So what do you think about this variant of the Annihilator list compared to the previous one, Mrigank? This one's obviously more tailored for this season in particular. But how do you think it would do?
I think it would do well. I like the inclusion of the two Vanguard Hunter units. As the season has gone on, a lot of the tactics in the GHB require a lot of board positioning. I think Intimidate the Invaders and the one that requires you to be on three separate board edges, or like two separate board on the board edges, but like two units with three units and two of them have to be outside your zone. I think Vanguard Hunters are extremely good at doing that one. I don't know if I'm particularly fond of both the endless spells. Maybe just one, maybe just the comet would be good, and I'd probably use the 30 points for a triumph in key situations if I had to. But I like the inclusion of Questor Soulsworn. I like the Vanguard Raptors. I have seen variations of this list that also try to run Tempestors, and maybe they're not as far long-ranged, but they sort of present a more upfront durable threat that your opponent has, like a sort of dual threat to focus on while they're fighting Annihilators as well. So yeah, overall, I think this sort of list will be the way to go. It does a lot of things that the older lists couldn't, which is it cuts down reactive damage with the help of things like the Astral Templar's immunity to monstrous rampages. It has a lot of long-range damage that can go out and touch things beyond lookouts. And like that's, again, a real problem for us. Previously, Annihilator lists could rely on shooting heroes off for the first turn or so. And then sort of use Annihilators against key units, and like that playstyle's gone because you don't want to be risking Vanguard Raptors up in their face. But Everblaze Comet is like a nice addition to get a little bit more of that splash damage to get through screens and stuff in the hero phase. Yeah, overall, just a good variation on that kind of list. I like it.
All right, well, taking that concept of tweaking the original concept, taking the Annihilator Grande, making it more suited to the season and the battle plans and everything, I took it one step further with this Drop the Hammer list that I've been playing and enjoying quite a bit. So this has even fewer Grand Hammers and Long Strikes. In exchange, you get Cavalry and Drakoth units. And the Drakoth of choice here is the Tempestors, because they are adding more shooting power, increasing the shooting score here from a 3 to a 4. And it also adds a Drakoth unit for battle tactics. So this unlocks Draconeth Destruction, which is, against most armies, an easy 2 victory points. So why I've been enjoying this one in particular is I think it solves a lot of the problems I have with this style of list. And one of the big ones is that the Grand Hammers are so central and so focused that when they fail a 7-inch charge, the game is it's a lot more difficult all of a sudden, right? What I like about this list is it's still got enough of that Grand Hammer package with the Questers, the Vanquishers, the Annihilators. You get 3 drops out of the Lord Imperitant. But it's not so heavily focused on them. You still have things like Evocators, 4 Tempestors. You've got the Long Strikes with Thunderbolt Volley. You've got it's almost like you're running 2 different lists, right? And when one list fails, the other list can then pick it up. The problem is neither of these is obviously a full proper list. But I found that the combination of these two has worked really, really well. A lot of the problems of the Grand Hammer list are solved by this.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I like the inclusion of Tempestors here. They present like a sort of more, like I said, durable targets, you know, 24 wounds. They come with their own sort of reactive damage, so they're generating value both on your turn and possibly the opponent's turn. I like the inclusion of the Questor Soulsworn instead of the Annihilators to sort of... One unit of Annihilators is enough to often threaten your opponent into deploying very conservatively, and you can take advantage of that with like more auxiliary units like Evocators and Tempestors as well. I don't know about the Liberators here, though, because I would much rather just go for the Triumph with the extra 10 points. Maybe you can use them for a screen. I don't know. I'm okay either way. Like, I wish I could use something like Sequiturs, because if Sequiturs are the same points as Liberators, I would totally use them as, like, this hedge against Death Armies to stop them from reanimating.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I feel that. I took the Liberators because this version of the list, I'm noticing in my... And, of course, it's always meta-dependent, right? But there's almost nobody running, you know, 1990 or 2000 point lists. So I would almost never get the Triumph. So I just said, okay, sure, I'll give one of my Vanquisher units +1 save. I'm only ever gonna put 5 Vanquishers in reserve. It's not gonna be like 2 of units ever go in reserve. Liberators are a nice thing to drop in front of Tempestors in case your opponent tries to shoot them out of the way and then get to the Tempestors. +1 save is better than not having +1 save.
The other thing that I've been noticing with sort of this similar kind of list building is people often go extremely lean and they cut out the Night Relictor entirely. they just go for an Enchanter and a Lord Imperitant. And because, you know, unlike our previous Annihilator Grande lists that were extremely slow, they were mobile, but extremely slow, this list is fairly fast. You can drop things like Tempestors from Reserves. Evocators move 12, so they can get to most midfield objectives pretty reliably. Obviously, the Annihilators are going in Reserves. The Questor Soulsworn can or can't be. It doesn't really matter. Whatever screens the Tempestors need can be in Reserves, and so can the Vanguard Raptors, or like or the other stuff can just run, you know, with the Lord of Peritons 3 CP or with the Heroic Action CP that you generated. So maybe you don't need a Knight Relictor, and I've been experimenting with some lean versions of that list that cut that out for something else. So possibly a Stormdrake Guard, who knows?
Possibly. I think I'd rather, before I cut the Knight Relictor, I think I'd rather cut at the Acolytes Battalion and go with Call for Aid from a Warlord Battalion before I do any of that, because it would just give me another screen, which is really useful in some matchups. But you really nailed what I'm liking about this list is the flexibility, right? Questers can or can be on the table or can be in reserve. Vanquishers can be on the table or in reserve. Knight Reckler translocation is an option. It's not something I'm completely dependent on because I didn't take that High Priest. Anytime I get translocation, it's a bonus for me. My opponent knows that it's more likely than not, so they have to play around the idea that I do get the translocation off. So it's not all in on the Grand Hammer concept, and it's way more spread out for battle tactics. The last thing I want to mention that's different about this list is making the Knight and Cantor the general. When that happens, you can go Spellcasting Savant instead of Overshadow. And Overshadow is really hard to do unless you're playing Hammers of Sigmar, because keeping all your Grand Hammers alive in Knights Excelsior is very hard. Keeping all your Vanguard Hunters alive in Astral Templars is very hard. All of these units are meant to die. And Overshadow in Hammers of Sigmar is still really tough because you have to kill all the enemy battle line. So this type of list doesn't have the mass damage output needed to kill, you know, let's say 180 zombies or all four Mega Gargants by the end of round 5, right? It's just shy of that max damage output that you can do with something like 4 Fulminators or 6 Dracolines. So what this gets instead is it goes for Spellcasting Savant, which is just to keep your general alive. And when you make the Knight Cantor your general, you can also take Shaman of the Chilled Lands. So you still have that Translocation Blizzard play available, but you also get to pick up Lightning Blast, which is a nice little D3 Mortal Wound ping that can help finish off screens, make space after a Thunderbolt Volley. It just adds a little bit of damage every turn because there's not really much worth casting Mystic Shield on here. And if you do need a Mystic Shield, well, that's where the Lord Imperitant comes in. So yeah, that's the last thing I want to say about this list is the special tech of the Knight and Cantor General. All right, let's talk tips and tricks, Mrigank. Let's go over this list here.
All right, so like we mentioned, the Annihilator lists almost play like you were in a Sniper's Nest, and you are calling in these tactical airstrikes, these, you know, almost like drop pods, if you want to get the Warhammer 40k reference from Annihilators. And for that reason, you almost never want to be full melee. You need shooting threats to take down either key targets, sometimes a screen, and sometimes just add to the damage of Annihilators so they can do what they need to do. Annihilators typically should land in one of two places. Where I found most useful is I punch a hole with the Raptors using a Thunderbolt Volley, and I land them in a place where I just cause the max amount of splash damage. Then I charge in, delete a key target, and then I just don't engage anything else if I don't have to. Annihilators have a really small footprint and a 5-inch reach effectively with a 3-inch pylon and a 2-inch weapon reach. So a lot of the time, you know, you can sort of like do pylons in this weird way where you're not engaging anything except the thing you're fighting. And this means your opponent has to waste resources and board space dealing with them the next turn, which is something you really want. It's a good thing. So yeah, one of the good things is you don't want to use Annihilators to deal damage to things like chaff and screens. That is what, so you want shooting typically in the hero phase, or you can take a turn and use sort of auxiliary units like crossbow adjudicators, vanquishers, to sort of deal, or you know, something like an Everblaze Comet and a Lightning Blast to sort of create enough of a hole for the Annihilators to where your opponent removes some key models and you land the Annihilators in the middle, and suddenly they have that opening they need for a 7-inch charge. From this list, the thing to note is because of how fragile and low model count and low wound count it is, it doesn't play like your traditional lists where you sort of like form screens in the midboard with objectives turns 1 and 2, and then sort of counterattack with your hammers in a typical Stormcast castle list. You typically just want to contest objectives. You know, if there's like, let's say 5 objectives on a board and your opponent controls 1 from the start of the game, try to control two. Don't try to control three. Don't try to like overstretch yourself and give your opponents board positions to which they can charge. Typically, try to just like edge onto an objective and just hold it just enough so you can get points. 4 to 5 points is good enough early on, and because you're planning on winning the mid to late game. Your plan should be to end your turns with key units outside of threat ranges. Annihilators are obviously just going to die, but your Vanguard Raptors, make sure that they are safe from your opponent's like countershooting or like a fast-moving cavalry unit or something like that. Make sure your Lord Imperitant is safe for the first two turns. For melee threat ranges, always ask about your opponent's movement, whether they have any run and charge abilities, any charging bonuses, any 3d6 charge abilities, things like that. And all this will matter because you will also need to account for this a lot of times in the double and then likely put a screen in the way if they have such abilities. Similarly, for their shooting units, ask about your opponent's, you know, shooting units, what their movement is, add that to their range, keep your long strikes out of it. Ask if they have any teleports available and account for that possibility if they do. So yeah, use Wildwoods on the turn, you know, if you're part of the playgroup or a tournament that uses Wildwoods, you know, think about how you could possibly use that to keep key units like the Lord Imperitant safe from shooting units. Yeah. Just these are just some like general play tips that sort of really pertain to Annihilator lists.
Hmm. Oh, we got a lot more to go. mm-hmm. In particular about teleporting shooting, there's a very once you learn this little trick, teleport shooting is a lot easier to deal with. And this trick is that most teleports finish more than 9 inches away from enemies. Right. So let's say you are teleporting something like a Tempestor, or you're dropping them into play from Sons of the Storm. They only shoot 12 inches. So the only things you can reach are enemies that are within 3 inches of the front line. So let's say you're trying to shoot past a screen. Well, you can only shoot something that's within 3 inches of the front of that screen. And this scales up to, you know, 18-inch range shooting. You just have to be more than 9 inches away. It gets a lot harder if you're dealing with units that have 24-inch or 30-inch shooting. Avoiding a teleport shot from that unit is very hard. Really, the only way to do it is to use things that block line of sight, like what Mrigank is saying, or reserves. Thankfully, Stormcast are one of the armies that has super long-range shooting that can also use reserves. So sometimes the right play is to keep your long strikes off the table for a turn, use another unit to destroy the enemy unit that could possibly threaten your long strikes. Then once it's safe on your second turn, drop them into play.
Now, this is more of a sort of how to play the general battle in a meta thing. Annihilator lists typically have way too many units to be one drop. We like going the MSU style. We typically don't use reinforced units unless they're like a Tempestor block or sometimes a Vanguard Raptor block or Adjudicator block. So oftentimes you will end up either using Warlord or whatever the, you know, flavor of the season battalion is, Galatian Sharpshooters, Antorian Acolytes. And for that reason, you will almost always get the counter drop your opponents who are trying to sort of beat the drop game. Luckily, as we mentioned, we are extremely good at, accounting for the double turn with this list. But B, counter deploying actually helps us because we're a very knowledge-based list. We want to maintain we want to stay outside of our opponent's threat ranges. But this also gives us an advantage because your opponent sort of knows that you're outside their threat range. They will let you go first, so you sort of have free range over the board and like what you get to hurt in your opponent's list early on. We have really long threat ranges, so we can survive double turns and still be extremely dangerous. We have toolkit units like Knight and Cantors because they help us. You know, if your opponent is one of those lists that really wants to take the alpha to, you know, either get their buffs up, Knight and Cantors are extremely good at turning those key buffs off. Mystic Shields, anything that, you know, provides a ward save or anything like that is pretty good. And our enhancements all sort of help us maintain our threat range too, particularly Call for Aid, since we can deploy like a screen early on and replenish it extremely easily way far back. So when going first, you should account for scoring battle tactics that are easy and that can be done safely for the first round, because there might be battle tactics you can't complete once your opponent's in range or you're stuck in the sort of brawling in the midboard. So Magical Dominance is a good example of this. Always account for the double. I cannot stress this enough. There's a lot of times where... Because you'll be in for a rude surprise if you don't account for the double, but sometimes you have to sort of give your opponent the turn because you want the double. you want to be getting two back-to-back turns on Annihilators and just blowing your opponent's list out, making them sort of like overcommit their resources. Your opponents know this, which is why I don't think out of like all the opponents I've ever fought with Annihilator lists, only two opponents have taken the first turn, and they both paid heavily for it because I was able to get it back to back with Annihilators, and they just generated so much value. I was able to delete something like 600 points out of their list with one unit of Annihilators.
I just want to hammer that point in real quick, because when your Grand Hammers charge, we keep saying they're going to charge and then die, right? When you get a double turn, they charge, and then they get another turn of charging. And it is devastating. It's just absolutely backbreaking. So that's why everybody will, if they've ever played against Annihilators, the next, like when they play you, they will force you to go first. It's just the most common thing you'll see.
Yep, and that goes to our next point. Your opponents want the Annihilators to be trading pieces. It's like, they're like pawns. You know, I take your pawn, you'll take my pawn. Your opponent, experienced opponents anyway, will know this, and so they will try to force this interaction. Your job is to either know this interaction and account for it, or then play to such a way where you can go for a back-to-back double and then sort of stymie their plans to sort of force this interaction on you. So like a turn one, sometimes I don't even bother engaging something with Annihilators. I'll like drop a unit of Vanquishers, clear a screen, clearing out the screen with shooting. Cool, you kill my Vanquishers, I'll call for aid. Now my Vanquishers are back. I have now countered for the double turn because I know where you're going to be roughly. So even if sometimes my opponents won't take, so if my opponents like know that they won't achieve anything, they'll give me the turn to turn my Annihilators back into trading pieces. But then most of the times they'll just take the turn, which is often a mistake. Or other times where I've won the turn, I'll be like, you know what? You can kill that Vanquisher unit all over again. I do not care. That puts you in prime position for Annihilators to land and do their job once more. And not to mention, when your opponents see Annihilators, they deploy like this in this incredibly cagey way where key units are like outside of three if like battle line units or like, sorry, frontline units. They'll often put units in the backboard, you know, to screen out any backfield charges on their heroes and stuff. But if you're forcing that army to move forward, you know, and they don't have like a whole ton of units to keep performing every role on the battlefield all at once, they will make a lot of space for you. Annihilators don't have that big a footprint, and your opponent needs to be extremely careful with their movement so that Annihilators don't just land in a tiny pocket somewhere and then completely wreck their back lines in like back-to-back turns.
Mm-hmm. Oh, this happens all the time right now because the battle tactic intimidate the invaders. Everybody's trying to score that at some point in the game, usually early on, mm-hmm. because they don't have any other easy tactics. So they'll move all their units up just enough to be out of their territory, and it's really hard to keep that denial on the 7-inch drop when you do that. So people frequently mm-hmm. move out of their territory, and all of a sudden you've got like your Grand Hammer missile can just go in and wipe out a whole bunch of support units, which could be the right play. Not always, but it could be. So that's mm-hmm. that's something to keep in mind.
Yeah. So when you go second, react to opponents moving onto objectives and sort of destroy key flanks. Remember, this game isn't about scoring every objective. It's just about holding more than your opponent for like 3 to 4 turns, possibly. So oftentimes, if you can just like force them in towards the center on a weak flank where they can't interact with you and you just stay away from them, that's good enough. You know, make them do the hard work of legging it up there. Meanwhile, you just keep shooting them. And then as they get close to your Annihilators, if you get a turn, cool, charge them. If you don't, never mind. As long as they've done their job and generated enough value, it should not be a problem for you. Questor Soulsworn is like an amazing unit. It's like the addition sort of this kind of list needed. They can take, you know, objectives by counting as 18, and typically, like, that used to be the problem, where if I killed something with 20 models and they had, like, 3 models left, I used to just be, like, punching myself. I'm like, come on, man. I just did so much damage and I achieved so much and I still didn't take the objective. Quest of Soulsworn really helped sort of shore up that problem, especially against a lot of, like, weak chaff units. And yeah, the way you play this is you always assume you will lose the priority roll-off. I'm not saying you can't play for a double turn. There are obviously cases where you can, but always account for you at losing the priority roll off at least once.
Yeah, you want to think every time you end your turn, okay, what happens during my opponent's next turn? How is he going to react? And if you're going at the top of the round, you need to think, okay, well, how are the next 2 turns going to go? Because there is a chance mm-hmm. of a double going. I'd say that's one of the hardest skills to learn in Age of Sigmar in general. And it's kind of like a cornerstone of playing this list. Like if you can't do this properly, you're not going to have a lot of success.
Nope.
All right, so what's the biggest problem for Annihilators, Mrigank?
Screens. You know, like, I've seen a lot of plays where people land Annihilators and they kill, like, 10 Karak Acolytes, or they'll kill, like, a unit of Hobgrots, or they'll kill, like, a unit of, what's it, like, Blood Reavers or something. And I'm like, that's a complete waste of time. Do not do this. Please don't land Annihilators in those positions. Always use shooting if you can. Thunderbolt Wally is an excellent tool. People often think it's a tool to sort of reinforce damage on key hammer units. And while that can be true, against something like an Iron Jaws list where you can target six pigs with it again and again, or something into like a Vanguard unit or something or try to get more damage in, and oftentimes it's better to just create a hole for your Annihilators and generate that value immediately turn one so you can apply that damage. Because sometimes your opponent, like... experienced opponents know this, and so they will account for Thunderbolt Wally, because if your opponents don't, let's say they have, like, a couple of key heroes that, you know, they're keeping just behind, like, a thin line of Crypt Ghouls, thinking, oh, yeah, they're safe, you know, my opponent, whatever, no matter what they do, they'll be forced to charge the Crypt Ghouls. Okay, now you've Thunderbolt Wallied and deleted, I don't know, even if you delete six Crypt Ghouls, you have now created a hole for your Annihilators to just punch through and delete all their heroes in the backfield. And that's a nightmare scenario for your opponent, so... You know, have that knowledge and use it wisely. If you want to spend a turn deleting their screens, that's okay too. You don't have to win the game turn one. You know, this is not an alpha striking list at all. It's okay to win like turn three, turn four. Yeah, always know the limits of Grand Hammer damage. It's always better to overkill than underkill. You want to typically commit some shooting or magic damage ahead of time and then sort of calculate your averages and see what's going to be possible into a unit. The worst thing you can do, and I have made this mistake on many an occasion, is get greedy with Annihilators, where I landed them to kill maybe a unit of Gorgrontes, but the Maw Crusher is just within range, and I'm like, oh, maybe I can kill the Maw Crusher if I, you know, roll well enough, and that's never going to work out for you. Don't get greedy. And for this reason, because, you know, the limits on their damage, they are not that good into massive wound count armies like Soulbite Gravelords, because Soulbite Gravelords... The way to deal with this kind of army is having sustainable threats, and Annihilators are not it. They are not sustainable threats. They are trading pieces 90% of the time, in my opinion. So the way you can only hold objectives against things is if you completely kneecap them, which is you often wipe them out, or you can force them to like go elsewhere, you know, not engage the Annihilators, but like go elsewhere on an objective. Questor Sword Sworn sort of help with this problem, since they have more wounds than 18 models, but again, this is a damage-based list, it's just not an alpha-striking list, so you do need to figure out how you're going to take objectives with a combination of damage from different units. Try and avoid taking any sort of reactive damage from Stomps and Leash Hells, you know. Charging is important, and it's crucial for Annihilators, but how you charge is equally as important. Try not to be within 3 inches of monsters. Try not to be within 6 inches of a shooting unit, or at least not as many models within six if you can help it. Try to make sure, for instance, if you're charging a shooting unit, remember that your drop mortals and charge mortals happen before they unleash hell. So don't put your charge mortals into another unit thinking, oh, you know, I'll just delete them with my melee damage. You have to account for things like unleash hell. And to this effect, things like Geminids charging in a throwaway unit like Aether Wings or like a Prosecutor unit often helps. You can play sub-factions like Astral Templars to be immune to picked picking you for monstrous rampages. Remember, Annihilators have like a 5-inch reach, like we mentioned, because they pile in 3 after their charge and all their weapons have a 2-inch reach. So even if you do want to hit a monster, consider charging something within the area and then piling in towards that monster. I've used that oftentimes to stay away from monstrous rampages, and it's worked out to pretty good effect. Because even something like a roar, even if it doesn't kill an annihilator, will actually drop their damage potential by quite a lot. You know, threes and twos, you end up missing like 3 or 4 rolls, and that's like cool. You've just lost 12 damage without doing anything. Battle tactics are an important consideration. We mentioned during the lists that we featured just a moment ago that Draconic Destruction and things like Lead into the Maelstrom, Intimidate the Invaders. These are all important. We need to be able to score at least 3 to 4 battle tactics extremely reliably in order to have a winning game plan. So consider that in your list building considerations and how you sort of, when you choose to pick these battle tactics to do. Try to do things like Magical Dominance, Intimidate the Invaders early on, because these rely on simple board positions, and with a combination of things like Vanguard Hunters and Translocation, they're pretty possible. And yeah, small little plug, we did make an episode on how to score Battle Tactics for Stormcast Army, Stormkeep episode 49. Check that out.
All right, let's take a look at some sample games. So this actually just came up. We did a video battle report with my friend Sarah. She had her Skaven army on the table against me. We were playing a league game, so it was more of a competitive style one. And for the full video, hopefully I can get a hyperlink to pop up on the screen now if you're interested in the full game. But I just wanted to note some key concepts of things we've been talking about in this video that I've noticed in the last few games I've played with Annihilator Lists. So here you can see what I call the Skaven 30-inch kill zone. That's because every single unit in the Skaven army, the highest amount of threat range they have is 30 inches. So the Storm Fiends, the thing I'm worried about there are the Wind Launchers, which are 24-inch range, and the Storm Fiends move 6 inches. So 6 plus 24, max teleport or max range is 30 inches. The Lightning Cannons, they only move 3 and they shoot 24, so they only have a 27-inch threat range. But both of these units can pop out of the gnaw holes, and when they come out of the gnaw hole, they have to be wholly within 6. So if you take their 24-inch shooting and that wholly within 6 value, add them together, you get a 30-inch threat zone. And what I've demonstrated here is that I deployed every single unit outside of any potential damage on turn 1. So Sarah wasn't able to do any damage to me. You can see the result of my deployment here. I put my Dracolines in the back, my Long Strikes further in the back, Aether Wings off to one side so that they could go and score Surround and Destroy in a future turn. On this battle plan in particular, this strategy worked well because this was a Geomantic Pulse, and the objective isn't really active in round one. So I can take a very passive round one. All I have to do is contest one objective, which is very easy to do by just dropping in some Vanquishers on the side or something. And this deployment made it so that I was just immune to taking any amount of damage on round one, unless I specifically chose which unit was going to drop in to contest an objective. So this is the kind of consideration you need to make when you're dealing with threat ranges. Of course, this is specific to this battle plan, this deployment, this list. Everything here is always specific, so it's not general, like, one-size-fits-all advice, but it is something to demonstrate the concept of threat ranges. The other example game I wanted to use here was a game, a more casual game I played against a Croak Seraphon Starborn list. And there's a couple things in this deployment that I wanted to point out. First off, I was able to get all of my heroes within 30 inches of Croak, so that I was able to have a heroic willpower unbind with the Relictor, the Arcane Tome on the Imperitant was able to unbind, and the Knight Incantor was in range to unbind with his Dispel Scroll. So I was able to have as many chances as possible to stop his spellcasting. But also note that the Long Strikes down there are more than 9 inches off the front line. This is super important because when Croak teleports forwards with a Slan, and this list he didn't have one in particular, but if a Slan is nearby, he can teleport Croak with a heroic action, and then the maximum range of Croak's spell is 18 inches. So if Croak has to teleport more than 9 away from me, and my units are more than 9 away from my front line, well, that means that I won't be within 18 no matter where he finishes his teleport. That means my Long Strikes are always safe from Celestial Deliverance, and the only damage that could possibly hurt them would be Comet's Call, since it has no range, and I have a Dispel Scroll ready to stop that. So this deployment in particular was very, very useful for me. I was forced to go first because I had more drops, and I took a very simple turn. I rushed the Vanquishers forward on the right side. I moved up everything a little bit just to deny more space for teleports and reserves because he was playing Dracothian's Tale. And I took the game from there. My opponent did not double me from what I remember, but if you want to read more about this game, you can check out our Discord server. We have it there in the battle reports forum. All right, let's talk about target priority. That's worth talking more about, right? Because it's one of these like skills, like knowledge-based skills that you have to develop. And Mrigank, you've got some examples here of how you typically deal with things like Iron Jaws, Lumineth, Slaanesh, and Khorne, if you want to run through how you handle all of those.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so the idea behind this was, you know, we often talk about target priority when we're discussing list building, or we don't really give examples of it to sort of, you know, highlight how you should approach a list. And oftentimes, you know, this is not an exhaustive list, obviously. And, you know, there's no like set way to approach certain armies. You know, people have, there's a wide variety of builds people have, and, you know, people build all kinds of crazy things. But hopefully, like, these examples should give you an idea of how to approach a list, how to approach builds, and sort of extrapolate from there. Obviously, experience with, you know, playing Annihilators is pretty important. You know, play practice games with different kinds of armies, and you typically realize, you know, what they're good at, what they're not good at. So I, for instance,
have fought Seraphon when they were spamming Soros Knights with poison and 3d6 charge on them, and I bungled up my target priority in that list, against that list, and I lost the first game. Then I faced them a second time 4 months later, the exact same list on the exact same mission, and I lost again, but I did a lot better, and I was mostly down to them rolling like some crazy amounts of sixes on their saves. But I had that game otherwise in the palm of my hand. But to give you some examples, Iron Jaw, since, you know, we're seeing the return of Iron Jaws with the big pigs, typically how they used to play, and they still might play this, or some version of this, is they used to form a ring with Gore Gruntas, Mokrasha in the center, and most Iron Jaws players will declare a Finest Hour turn one, because they don't want you shooting the Mokrasha off the board with the Thunderbolt Wally and a combination of Raptors. Don't engage the Mokrasha. It's a trap. It's a total trap, because if something goes wrong, if you do not manage to kill that Mokrasha for whatever reason, you know, you're below average rolls, they're above average rolls, you have wasted a turn doing nothing, and they are now in your face, turn one, position for a double. Mm-hmm. That's the worst situation to be in. So the way to win against this is you use a combination of Thunderbolt, Wally, Tempesters, Raptors, you know, shooting, and Annihilator drop to kill as many Gore Gruntas as you can. Luckily, this list operates with zero screens. Everything that is a screen in this army is also the hammer unit in this army. So if you can clear them off, as many Gore Gruntas as you can, and you leave like a Mokrasha and maybe three Gore Gruntas alive, you have done like 90% of the work. You can put Vanquishers in the way. You can put Aether Wings in the way to account for things like Mighty Destroyers, Fast Un. You can even put a hero in the way if you have to. You don't just move a hero up. If you want to deny them a teleport, just deny it with a Night Encanter. After that, it's done its job. If they want to engage it, cool. That's on them. You don't care. Just declare Finest Hour, hop into some cover inside a building, and hope for the best. And I have actually survived like an Iron Jaws charge because they charged a Night Encanter that was in cover with Finest Hour and all-out defense, and they couldn't hurt it with like an entire Maw Crusher. That is typically how you would approach a match like that.
Yeah, I think you're right about targeting the Gruntas instead of the Mokrasha. It may be tempting to say, oh, look, there's a big, you know, 450 point or whatever they costed him these days, big monster, and I can take it out. That seems really appealing, right? Just in terms of numbers, like I can take out a big expensive thing. And yes, it is appealing because it can issue Mighty Destroyers three times, and it feels like you're going to cripple the army if you get rid of it, right? But if you get rid of all the pigs, what is the Mokrasha issuing those commands to, right? Its value just drops off tremendously if it has nothing left to buff. And in this particular case, it's about unit count. The less units your opponent has on the table, the less options they have. If your opponent just has a single Mokrasha, you can more or less predict where it's going to go. Right? Like, it's really hard because, in particular with Mokrashas, because they got the Fast Un and the Teleport and the Mighty Destroyers, but it's one model. It's one unit. Whereas if your opponent had three different units of pigs, it's a lot harder to control three different units than it is to control one. The Mokrasha will kill whatever they charge, but they're not going to kill three units with three different units of Gruntas, right? Also, just look at it in terms of numbers. The Mokrasha is 18 wounds on a 3-up. They're going to Finest Hour, so they're on a 2-up. They're going to all-out defense, you're shooting, so they're on a 1-up. Versus the Gore Gruntas, who are going to be on a 4-up save with 15 wounds, and the best they can do is all a defense for a 3-up. So you're effectively just making it much harder for yourself if you just try to pour all your damage into the Mokrasha. Pretty much always go for the Gruntas. Kill all the Gruntas, and the rest of the list just falls apart.
Mm-hmm. And actually, with the big pigs, it might actually get easier, because
yes,
those things are expensive.
They have a worse wound density and a 4-up save.
Yes. So, and they can't, from my knowledge, I don't think there's a mega boss in there in that Trugs whatever army, so they don't have access to multiple all-out defense, so you can really take advantage of that. Lumineth Realm Lords, you want to disable that 5-up wards, put a Night Encanter in danger if you have to. As long as you can do that, you're fine. And this is a list that'll typically try to take turn one from you because they want to get their 5-up ward up. So if you can account for that and double them, the game's just instantly over. You want to typically clear any Warden screens or any Dawn Rider screens using Thunderbolt Volley. There is a minus one to hit, so you might need to commit slightly more resources than you normally do. And then you want to land some Annihilators and Tempesters, or, you know, even Questor Soul Sworn to basically clear out the Wardens, or, you know, if you've created a big enough hole, charge in and destroy their Sentinels. Mm-hmm. If you get a back-to-back, the game's over.
Yeah. Two other really big spells to watch out for with Lumineth. I guess three things. Sorry, I'm just going to add. First off, just watch out for lore seekers, right? They're going to deploy after deployment. Just make sure your whole army isn't completely split up so that you have that dispel scroll ready to deal with, you know, the blizzard or the pendulum or whatever they're going to throw in your face that turn one. The other two key spells that they're going to cast, one of them is only usually Teclis casting it. It's the teleport spell. It's the Wind Mage and Teclis that cast it. Canceling that is huge, right? Because you can just stay out of threat ranges normally by just deploying properly and moving properly. And if they can't teleport, they can't hit you. So if you stop the teleport, you're taking no damage and you're laughing, right? The other key spell is Speed of Hish, because Lumineth are a slow army. Dawn Riders are fast, sure. But Dawn Riders aren't the biggest threat. They can whiff and fail to kill five Liberators even. You know, like they're not going to table you. If they charge you, best case scenario, they kill a screen. What is a threat, though, are things like Wind Charger or Wind Riders going, you know, stupidly fast, 28 or 32 inches with flying, or even just Blade Wardens or Blade Lords. Giving them a 12-inch move is the difference between them charging that turn and not charging. And a turn of a melee hammer not doing any damage means that unit is just taking up space. They're just a screen, effectively. So canceling out Speed of Hish can be the game-winning play, depending on the scenario.
Mm-hmm. The other thing you have to watch out for is things like, we mentioned, reactive damage, like Sentinels and stuff. But luckily, Sentinels don't have a lot of, like, output. They only have, like, a unit of 10 Sentinels has, like, 9 shots. So with a combination of Annihilator drops and a Mortal Wound charge, you should be able to reduce their, like, output to, like, maybe out of 20, maybe they'll do, like, 10 shots and kill maybe an Annihilator, and you'll just still cleave through them. So while we said that it's okay to avoid, that you should try to avoid reactive damage like a Leash Hell, in a lot of cases, remember that if you're okay making that trade and you'll know you'll still cut through them regardless, sometimes it's okay. You can risk it.
Mm-hmm. And don't forget, the charge mortal wounds happen before on Leash Hell. Don't let anyone tell you otherwise.
Yep. And to that end, we should go to Slaanesh, which is one of the big bad boys right now. Clear out their screens so typically how Slaanesh lists will deploy is they'll hold about 44 Blitzbarb archers in closely grouped together. They will hold a contorted epitome with them, typically Sigvald and like another Lord of Pain or something like a Shard Speaker with them. They'll screen out with a unit of Slickblades and a unit of Blitzbarb Seekers, sometimes two units of either one of those, some combination of four Wound Cavalry. And your goal should be in this one to clear out their screens turn one. Because they're such a wound-dense screen in this case, and you know they're cavalry bases, so they're pretty wide, you often won't be able to clear it with just a Thunderbolt Volley. That'll usually not be enough. So account for the threat range, account for the double, and then essentially just take a turn and just try to clear out their four wound screens. Once that is done, their list becomes a lot more vulnerable to counter-shooting and Annihilator drops. And from then on, because they're so tightly grouped together, you should be able to do a lot of damage by landing and charging Annihilators. Ultimately, this list is one of those where, like, we mentioned how Annihilators are trading pieces, and so the meta becomes way too efficient in terms of points to damage. It's not good. And Blitzbarb Archers, I think, are just past that tipping point. But if, fingers crossed, they are due for a nerf, then I think this list becomes a lot more beatable. But this is the general, like, idea of how you should be thinking about fighting this list.
Yeah, Slaanesh is probably less of a concern than some of the other armies that need to be toned down a bit, let's say, just because they're so fragile, right? Like if you, I think another way to go with this matchup is to drop Grand Hammers into that screen and just take it out and then rely on your shooting to kill all the Blitzbarbs. Because one problem with Slaanesh is they are max 30-inch range threat range on all the Blitzbarbs.
The issue is the triple Unleash Hell. If it was just one Unleash Hell, I would risk it. But the fact that Pretenders can do that three times means you have to handle it a little bit differently.
Right, and that's why one of the ways you could approach this matchup is by shooting their Blitzbarbs one unit at a time, right? Put up Mystic Shield on your Tempestors, translocate them into range, and then focus fire your Long Strikes and Tempestors one unit at a time into the Blitzbarbs. You should be able to reliably kill one unit of 22 every turn. And then that's three turns. The only thing in range for them to shoot should be the Tempestors, who will have Mystic Shield and a lot of defense. So you're going to be on a 2+ and laughing because hopefully your Grand Hammers have killed the Blitzbarb Seekers that would give them bonus rend. The Slaanesh one is interesting. You can take it in very different ways. Just careful play, careful allocation of resources, carefully playing around that triple unleash is really key.
Mm-hmm. And from then we move on to Khorne. The thing that they are going for most of the times is either bloodletter spam, bloodthirsters with blood reavers to support, halo of blood on a particular insensate bloodthirster so they can fight first. What's the other one? The Argath, King of Blaze, to avoid wards, but you don't really care about that one. You don't have any in this list. Or these type of lists usually don't have one. So remember, we mentioned how you can sort of avoid reactive damage, like Monstrous Rampages, by charging away 3 inches away and then piling in. That also sort of applies to Strike First. Strike First happens at the start of combat phase. So if you're at the start of combat, you are 3 inches away because you tagged another unit by staying within half an inch of them. You can let them activate Strike First, nothing's within range so they don't fight, and then you get to fight them. So knowing how to position your Annihilators and charging wisely is going to be the key. We often mention how we try to delete screens with Thunderbolt Volley or spend a turn deleting screens before we charge Annihilators in. This is a list where you can sort of afford to punch holes through and just punch through them to delete key units, but not every single unit, because you might end up buffing them if you sort of kill too many units early on. So this is one where it's okay to like sort of cripple units, but not kill them outright. Like if you reduce like a Blood Reaver screen to like 2 models or 3 models and then charge Annihilators through to something else and don't finish that Reaver unit off, that actually works in your favor, particularly because this is Khorne. You don't want to give them more Blood Tide than you have to. The Guided by Lightning lands Thunderstrike infantry units 7 inches away. Remember that this will turn off whatever wards that their demon units have, the Locus of Khorne. This means that when your long strikes shoot them from 30 inches away, they will not have a 5-up ward up. So you can use this to your advantage a lot of times.
And that'll wrap up this episode. Thank you, everybody, for watching. Hopefully the wait for this Annihilator episode has been worthwhile, is what I wanted to say. We've been talking about Annihilators for years, and we finally got around to making this video. So thank you, everybody, for tuning in, especially to our Patreon and YouTube supporters. Thank you guys for keeping us funded so that we can justify spending, you know, an hour and a half talking about a niche unit in the lowest win rate army in the game. So if you think we missed anything, you know, if you have your thoughts on Annihilators, please leave them down below in the comments, or feel free to jump onto our Discord server and complain at us directly in person.
If you have any questions, like, we're active in the Discord all the time, please feel free to reach out. Hopefully this, like, the information we covered helps you out in playing Annihilators. I know a lot of people requested this, but really, guys, it just comes to taking this information and practice. That's all it is.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. The Stormkeep Discord server is a great place if you want to learn about Stormcast, in addition to other armies. But we have a number of battle reports featuring this like 7-inch Scions drop style that we're talking about here. So feel free to jump in there and take a look at those battle reports. We also have everybody just gushing about their models. We have some brilliant painters on there who are really doing inspiring stuff. We have community contests right now, depending on when this video comes out. We're hosting a painting Antorian Locust contest. So if you have a foot wizard from any faction, doesn't have to be Stormcast, you can drop it in there for a chance to win some fabulous prizes. And we do list building for all armies, not just Stormcast. We have dedicated players from every faction, every Grand Alliance that are talking about this game all the time. Consider supporting the gang by becoming a member on YouTube or joining us on patreon.com/thestormkeep. For $5 a month, you can get early access to all our videos, as well as access to the slides we use in these videos. So if you want them for quick reference, you can get them. Coming up next on the podcast, we are still hard at work at How to Counter Khorne. We put a lot of effort into these How to Counter videos. We like to go really far in depth, so hopefully the wait has been worthwhile. We're also working on updating our Stormcast Allies video. Remember the one we made? It's been like 2 years now at this point. Well, there's been a lot of Battletome updates since then, and we are ready to look at Allies with a fresh look, especially Cities of Sigmar. It is tragic what has happened with that army.
Yeah, I mean, there's a particular priest that might be a good slot in, but I can't imagine anything other than that.
Mm-hmm. We're also looking at updating our faction identities. This is deep lore for our channel, but back in December last year, we did a live stream just talking about the concept of faction identity. We looked at the strengths and weaknesses of factions, their general playstyle, narrative hooks, and things like that. And I remember saying that, you know, once more battle tomes come out for third edition, we're going to go back and update that video. And with the Cities of Sigmar book and maybe some undead bone boys coming soon, It looks like we're ready to do an update to that video, so look forward to that. So with that said, thank you everybody for tuning in, and we will see you in the next one.
See you guys.